Good morning, everyone, and welcome to another service seminar. My name is Ryan Kelly, and I'm here with Sean Lakin from Beaver Coach Sales and Service. He is the service manager, fixed operations manager. He's just a one-man encyclopedia of RV knowledge.
Gee, thanks.
Yeah, man.
Appreciate it.
It's pretty accurate. You've bailed me out multiple times where I call you for seemingly difficult problems, and you just say, hey, turn the power on, and it works. So I appreciate that.
Glad to be able to help.
So we're here today because you guys, the viewers, the customers, our clientele, our family and friends, have reoccurring questions that keep coming up again and again. And we figured if you guys have those questions, then maybe, just maybe, other people who own RVs or are interested in buying an RV have those same questions. So we're going to address those here today with Sean. He's going to share his knowledge and expertise and kind of shed some light on a few of these questions. With that, you want to jump into it?
Sure.
Are you ready?
Yep, I'm ready.
Now, Sean has not seen this list previously. We just handed it to him moments ago. So this is going to be his fresh perspective on, he has done no research whatsoever. So we'll see how well he does today.
That's the way I like it.
Yep. So first question, someone, who is this? I guess, can we use their name? So-and-so from so-and-so-where says, good morning, do you do body work on Tiffins or can you recommend? Thanks.
Actually, we do body work on pretty much everything. It doesn't matter if it's a fiberglass sidewall or if they're tin sidewalls or Phylon or whatever the case may be. So we do body work on all RVs. We have a 60-foot downdraft paint booth. We've got two guys back there that have a combined probably 60 years of experience doing paint and body work. They were some of the factory technicians that were applying these finishes to the Beaver coaches back when they were coming off the line, and everybody knows that they had some really high quality multicolor base coat, clear coat paint jobs. So yeah, our guys can fix anything. We've got an industrial chop gun. If we have to rebuild part of a front cap or a back cap or a wheel skirt or something like that, there's a fab shop right down the street that builds our can doors. We have a lot of moldings and trims that other places don't stock just because we do so much paint and body work. So the answer is definitely yes, and it's all models, not just Tiffins.
And it's Mary Lou Hansen is the gal who asked that question. I just found it here on the sheet. So Mary Lou, if you need body work done, I apologize for whatever happened on your RV. So hope you get that resolved soon. Call and make an appointment with our service department and let's get that in and get that item fixed. Unfortunately, there is, you know, a lot of body damage that comes in that we work on. And it seems like most of the time you're going less than a mile per hour backing up, or you're driving through a gas station. We see that a lot. One of those yellow poles becomes a nuisance. But most of the time, you're going pretty slow. It's not like these big collisions that happen on the highway that bring people in with body damage. It's scrapes. It's little crunches in the back cap. It's hitting a rock. It's hitting the corner of a building. It's going really slow. So I think as a preventative way to avoid body damage on your RV, when you're backing up, always have a spotter. Even though you've done it 100 times and it's that one time you don't have a spotter and you're looking out that mirror and something's going on this side is when you're going to cause those issues. So keep that in mind.
Yeah, you have anything that you experience in your car, you know, deer are going to jump out in front of you. Your stopping distance in a motorhome is about four times what it is in your car at mm-hmm. equal speed. And so if you just keep a, you know, health, obviously things like that, you're not going to be able to avoid completely. But when you're in traffic, you know, make sure that you have a healthy distance behind the car in front of you. As everybody out there that's ever driven a motorhome knows, people don't have a lot of respect for RVers. They kind of see them as impeding their way through traffic. They like to crowd you, and so, yeah, just try to maintain a healthy distance and stay safe.
That's good. Okay, next question is from a gentleman named Bill N. Aaron, or maybe it's Bill and Aaron. It says Bill N. It's kind of like Lewis N. Clark. I wonder what his middle name was. They say
Meriwether, I think.
Meriwether.
Yeah.
Meriwether?
Clark.
Lewis and Clark? Yeah. Now, was that two guys or one? Lewis.
Those two guys.
Lewis and Clark.
I think it was Meriwether Lewis.
No.
Yeah.
They had a Newfoundland dog. Newfoundland. Yeah. Very, very clever. Okay. We digress. What do we got here? He and she, say, I'd like to hear about recommendations for fluid changes, including transmission and rear differentiator. Maybe how often the chassis needs to be greased. That's a good question.
So fluid changes, I would say that you need to consult first your owner's manual. A lot of these things, I know we've kind of beat this subject to death, that a lot of it is time-based, like it'll say X amount of miles or annually. A lot of them are based on conditions, like when you have these big diesel engines, you got to imagine that most of them are not dedicated or built for the RV industry. They're built for, you know, long-haul trucks, short-haul trucks, off-road equipment, stuff of that nature. And so a lot of their service intervals are based off hours of operation, also taking into account the conditions that they're operated under. So definitely follow the owner's manual, for one. So for two, transmission kind of depends on what transmission and what type of fluid. Like in the Allison transmission with standard ATF, the service interval is 15,000 miles. With Transcend, it can be extended far beyond that. So it just kind of depends if you're using synthetic fluids or if you're using standard, you know, oil-based lubricants. Greasing the chassis, I would grease the chassis every time you have the oil changed.
Okay. So same thing, either time or some people just do it once a year.
Right.
Okay. I think that answers it. Good. Here's a sales question. I'll take this one. This is a guy named Roy Keith Sr. He says, I just got a 2018 F-350 and it is loaded and I haven't made my first payment yet and would rather have an RV. What can I do? Well, Roy Keith Sr., luckily if you got a pickup right now in this market, it is super, super, super hot. You can probably sell that thing for what you're in it if you sell it private party. If you take it to a dealership, then they gotta obviously bring it back or retail and then sell it for retail and make a profit on it. But put that thing on Craigslist or you know, start asking around with your buddies if someone's in the market for it. It's a hot time to sell a truck right now. So sell that, take that cash, come on in, and let's sell you an RV. That's my thoughts.
Sounds good to me. Yeah, it's really hard to get, especially a diesel pickup truck now.
No one's got inventory right now with and you know what's funny is what's happening now with a lot of these manufacturers is there's only so many of these computer parts available for Ford and for Chevy and GMC. So they're only making units for like service trucks. To keep, you know, fleets available, and then they're only making the really high-end trim packages. So as a result, there's going to be a little bit of a deficit in those kind of medium trim packages. So it's tough to find inventory right now. So yeah, sell that sucker dog and let's get you into an RV. Okay, next question. How hard is it to maintain your RV? That is an open-ended question, Sean.
I guess it depends on, are you going to maintain your RV yourself or are you going to have somebody else do it for
That's
you?
Very
Obviously,
true.
If you're going to have somebody else do it for you, then it's not that difficult. There are some things that you definitely want to be aware of. I mean, as the seasons progress throughout the course of the year, there are different things you have to do. You have to take into account, you know, winterizations. If during the fall, usually
sure.
is when it's raining, you want to make sure that you're up there checking your roof and make sure it's sealed properly so you're not getting water leaks. You know, properly storing your coach so that you're not attracting, you know, pack rats and mice and things of that nature. Make sure that if there are any easily accessible places where you know, varmints can get in there, that there's nothing mm-hmm. in there for them to eat. There's no reason for them to nest, things of that nature. Keeps them out of there. So yeah, I mean, it can be as difficult as or as easy as you choose to make it. And mm-hmm. also leading into the next question, is it expensive to maintain an older RV? As anybody knows, there are certain issues with used cars, how they've been stored, the condition that they've been maintained in, you know, previous to you owning it, all of these things, and you know, the make, model, and type of car. Some
sure.
some cars are just have inherent problems, and others don't. So yeah, I would say that first, has it been stored, you know, properly? Has it been maintained properly? Can you produce, or can the person that you're purchasing it from produce the service records so you know that it's been stored and maintained properly? Roof sealer is something that you need to check every year, and it'll typically last for 3 to 5 years. You can overlay it one time, And then after that, it needs to be cut off and reapplied. And, you know, in that process, check your roof AC covers, make sure they don't have cracks in them. Check your roof vents, make sure they don't have cracks in them. Check your, you know, skylights, make sure they don't have cracks in them. Anything that looks obvious, and when you're doing your annual, you know, roof check, take a tube of caulking up there with you and just hit those little areas as you see them. There'll be, you know, different things that'll cause bubbles in that roof sealer, like two dissimilar seals may cause some gassing, and that's why you'll see little bubbles, or there's air trapped in there and you'll see little bubbles. If they get those will get dried out and brittle. Cut them out, put some sealer in them. If you see cracks, fill them with sealer, overlay them.
That's good. That's going to lead into the next question about what are some main causes of RV leaks. But before, let's stay on this about the maintenance. I think ultimately what you're saying is it needs to come down to an active, you have to have an active approach to maintenance on your RV, not a passive approach. It's not, I'm just going to park it for 6 months and pick it up and turn the key and everything's going to be perfect. It's as you're using it, be mindful of ways that you can prevent, you know, things happening on it. And when you're, before you store it, make sure that you're set up where you're preventing things happening. If you have batteries that have the water on it, just because it's in storage doesn't mean you don't need to put more distilled water in it, right?
Right. And things like batteries, you know, if they are left in a state of discharge for extended periods of time, they go bad. They sulfate.
Yeah.
If they're left in a situation where they're being charged constantly and they don't have any water in them, it'll burn them up. You know, they'll ruin your batteries. So if a healthy 12 or 6 volt battery is left in a full state of charge, it will not freeze. Once you draw it down to, you know, half of its normal charge, then the freeze point starts to rise, and so it'll freeze at a much lower temperature or much higher temperature.
Mm-hmm. So just active approach to maintenance. There's no such thing as a perfect RV.
Think about it like an airplane.
They are built by man.
Yeah, think about it like an airplane, like your pre-flight check before you go somewhere. Have yourself a checklist. Have yourself a maintenance checklist. When was the last time I checked the oil? When was the last time I changed the oil? When was the last time I checked the transmission fluid? Change the transmission fluid. They make cheap little litmus strips that are like $3 a piece. You can dunk them in your coolant. It'll tell you if your coolant needs any chemical additive, if the freeze point is correct, and things of that nature. If there are other elements present in the coolant that could be detrimental to the engine block and things of that nature. So for $3, you know, it's a good investment. You can send oil samples off to Caterpillar, and there are other laboratories out there that'll test them, and it'll tell them if there are certain trace elements in the oil sample that would tell you that, you know, you have a bearing issue or you know, worn bushings or something like that inside the motor, or if maybe the coolants or the oils or whatever are contaminating each other. And so, yeah, stuff like that is important. It's relatively inexpensive when you take into account how much it costs to rebuild an engine or transmission.
Yeah, preventative costs almost always are going to save you so much in percentage too than the actual fix that if it breaks. So that's good. Active approach to owning your RV. Yeah, don't take a passive approach to it, because it's going to end up costing you. So keep an eye on these things. Okay, so Sean, what is the main cause for leaks in RV roofs?
Mostly it's lack of maintenance that we just touched on, you know, just ignoring a problem until it gets to the point where if you see that there's water coming into the coach, something's been ignored, unless it's a new unit and it was just a defect from the factory and, you know, the factory did a poor job of sealing it, or there's a bad joint or something like that. There are other issues that can lead to water leaks, like if you have impact damage. You know, we see once in a while where a tree limb or something has fallen, or somebody's gone through a park and they've hit a tree limb and it's put a crack in the cap. That's not typical. You know, torn rubber roofs, that's, you know, something that's fairly common because rubber's not as resilient as fiberglass. But for the most part, it's just neglecting to address the roof seal issues. Also, you know, a lot of people don't know, and it's kind of not something that is stand out in bold letters in the owner's manual. The air conditioning units require, you know, retorquing of the bolts. And what the seal in between the air conditioner and the roof eventually collapses down to the point where it's very, very thin and it's not offering a lot of protection, and the air conditioner is just kind of sitting up there. You could physically move it with your hands back and forth because the seal has been completely compressed. And so, you know, every year those bolts need to be torqued, and then every few years those gaskets need to be replaced. So that's a very much overlooked component of the roof.
Yeah, and if you start getting water in through there, then yeah, you're in trouble because you got a mess on your hands. How much does it cost to replace an AC unit?
Depends on the unit. Air conditioning units are rated in, you know, cubic feet per minute. So how many cubic feet a unit is going to cool? Some of them are, you know, 12 fives up to 15,000 cubic feet. And then also, if they have different methods of also heating the air, some of them are heat pumps where it actually, via a reversing valve, creates, you know, hot air instead of pulling the hot air out of the coach and replacing it with cold air. And then others have a heat strip in there that's like an element, and the air passes over that element and heats the air going into the coach. So because there's so many variations, I mean, an inexpensive roof air conditioner is probably right around $1,000. So it's $1,000, and an expensive one is double that.
Yeah.
Maybe, you know, maybe 2.5 times.
Like a low profile 15,000 BTU Penguin or something. Cool. Yeah. So preventative maintenance on the roof again. Go up there and just check it. You can tell on the sealant when you start getting cracks and starts fading in color. It's time to go up there and touch it up. And that, I mean, you can do it on your own, or you could bring it to an RV shop or have it done. You can be as hands-on as you want with your maintenance. It just, do it to your skill level and know what things that you want Sean and his boys to look at and what things you can tackle on your own. So, Sean, how do you prevent freezing of an RV water hose? That is a great question.
There's only two ways I know of. One is a heated hose. You know, the other is insulating your hose and then keeping a constant source of flow. So like cracking a faucet or something of that nature. That's really about the only thing that you can do. Get yourself a good heated hose is probably the best answer.
Mm-hmm. And we sell those here. We sell through a lot of those because it's cold in Central Oregon in the morning, even in the summertime. So we always have those in our store. Okay, Sean, how to tighten wheel lug nuts without a torque wrench?
I mean, you can tighten a wheel lug nut with a wrench or with an impact gun or a breaker bar and a socket, whatever method you deem available and necessary. But in order to torque the lug nuts, you have to have a torque wrench. And nobody, with the exception of maybe a very select few people, are going to invest in $1,200 torque wrench is capable of going up to 1,000 foot-pounds.
That's right.
And usually that's a two-man operation just to torque the lug nuts. You know, you need a special socket that's for the lugs on your coach, and then you're going to need a bud nut socket for the inners on the rear wheels as well. So, yeah, most people won't do that. Yeah, take it into a truck center and just have them torque the lug nuts on your coach is probably the best answer.
That's good. And what is the ideal tire pressure?
The ideal tire pressure is one of two pressures. One is the one that is printed on the placard, usually behind the driver's seat, that shows the recommended tire inflation. The other one is to run your coach, whatever your coach may be, across a set of scales and get your specific axle weights, and then consult the tire manufacturer.
Okay, that's good. And is it bad for the tires to run below 30 PSI?
Oh, yeah. They'll ruin them. They'll ruin them in a handful of miles. So, yeah, you definitely want to make sure your tires are properly inflated.
Okay.
And once you've run a tire, low for an extended period of time, that tire is no longer viable. You will have sidewall degradation, and that will lead at some point to a blowout, likely.
Here's an interesting question. Why is the tire air measured in PSI?
because we measure everything in pounds because we're American.
You're American.
If it was Britain, it would be in whatever
kilos
whatever
or
metrics conversion that is. It'd be in kilometers. It'd be
they only have pound cakes.
Kilograms.
Over there. Kilograms. Kilometers. Kilimanjaro.
Kilograms per square. I don't know.
Space.
Meter or something.
I don't know. That's
or
why
kilopascals.
We do that because we live in America.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's the technical answer, I guess.
And what does PSI stand for? What's the acronym?
Pounds per square inch.
Why don't they call it PPSI then?
I don't know.
Obviously, I just said it out loud.
It's 25% longer.
All right. Let's see here. Oh, should travel tires be rotated?
Trailer tires, yes. You should definitely.
Back that up. Okay. Should trailer tires be rotated?
Well, the funny answer would be they get rotated.
They rotate every time
you drive it.
Sean, I rotate these every time I drive.
But the not funny answer is if you have dual axles and you notice that there is excessive wear on the front axle or the rear axle, it's usually going to be the trailing axle that scrubs, then definitely rotating them is going to extend the life of the tire. So,
that's a good idea. Man, we got asked. This is a lot of tire questions popping out. This is great. What does 215 55R 17 94V mean on tires?
So basically, it's the height, the width, and the rim size is typically the information that you're going to find on a tire. Different sizes are going to obviously have different values for those. Different R is the rim. Next.
Next.
We could be on tires all day long.
That was the last tire question, probably.
Yeah.
Okay, next was, this is kind of interesting. It says, where do RVs get power from? It's not like Iron Man, a core where it draws all of its energy from.
His little palladium power plant.
Or Superman, where it gains its strength from our sun.
So where do they get their power from? Well, one is from plugging it into the wall. You can you're using 110 power in either 50 amps or 30 amps or 15 amps. Secondly, you can have an inverter, and the inverter basically takes 12 volt direct current and turns it into 120 volts of AC current, and that's what's used to power all of your interior appliances that are like the appliances that you have at home. And then third would be battery power, direct 12 volt, so anything that runs on DC current. Fourth would be like solar panels where you're generating using power from the sun. Fifth would be the alternator on the engine. So if the engine's running, you're generating 12 volt power. There's a little device in there. It's either going to be in the form of a battery isolator or a relay and a solenoid that is latching those two banks of batteries together and allowing the alternator to charge them as a single unit. And then sixth, I believe, would be the generator, where you're actually producing your own power. So, yeah, those are...
Did you say solar already?
Yep.
Okay. I zoned out for like two of those. I'm like,
that's
God,
okay.
You're on six. I thought it'd be like two. Like, oh, you plug it in the wall, you run your generator.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
So lots of different sources.
Yeah.
Very cool. Okay, so this kind of rolls right into... this is an interesting question. What happens to lead acid batteries when they run out of water?
If a battery runs completely out of water,
it's bad.
You're probably going to be replacing that battery really soon.
The reason
you can add distilled water back in, but usually when they're boiled off down to the point where you're putting a gallon of water in per battery, you have a bigger issue, overcharging, shorted cell, things of that nature. You're going
to
cause some
the
damage.
Reason why I think it's interesting, it's not so much what physically happens to the battery, what happens to the rest of the units in your coach. Now you go to a complete dead state. Is there stuff that needs to be resetted? Can it cause electric issues?
Is everything pretty good nowadays? There are some things that can happen with older coaches, especially. Like, I've seen late 90s, mid 90s coaches where, like, the ECU for the engine has basically like a capacitor, like an internal battery in it. And so it, and that is meant to maintain the presets that the manufacturer deemed necessary for that particular application. And what happens is once that power source is depleted because the batteries are in a deep state of discharge, then it loses all of its presets. And in many cases, then the engine won't start. And that's where we are seeing a lot of these, like, barn find, you know, great deal.
Yeah.
We had 20,000 miles on it, kind of.
Everything worked last time I used it.
Right, 10 years ago. But we're having issues. Daily, I probably receive a dozen phone calls that are something like this. Hey, I found this old coach, got a great deal on it. I'm trying to get it started, you know? And so in a lot of cases, things like that, it can definitely affect them detrimentally. New ECUs, $2,800 bucks.
And I guess to answer their question specifically, what happens to the battery is you get the bulging.
It's probably just never going to be brought back up to a full state of charge no matter what you do to
it. You need new batteries.
Distilled water in it. You can try to nurse it back to health by bringing it back up from a very low state of charge, you know, a couple amps over many days. But more than likely, it's probably never going to be the same.
So let's go kind of off script here a little bit. We're going right through all those questions. But you brought up something about finding barn burner deals and stuff that's probably needs to be talked about, because right now in this market, because inventory is so low at a lot of dealerships, people are seeing that their coach is probably worth more this year than it was the last 2 years, you know. So they're selling RVs on their own. So there's a big market right now for used RVs. There's not a lot out there, but there's a lot of people now more than ever that are selling their RVs because they're thinking they're getting top dollar for it. So with that, we're seeing people coming in with these barn burner deals of used RVs that maybe haven't been touched for a couple years. In your experience, Sean, it's kind of a loaded question. Is it more cost effective to buy one from a dealership that's gone through it, or to find a barn burner and just kind of roll the dice from a service and maintenance standpoint?
I think that's a broad question, because if you have the time and the knowledge and the tools and the location and the ability
to
repair something on your own, obviously you're going to be, you know, minus the labor portion of repairs and bringing it back up to speed. But that's not very common.
Sure.
Most of the time it is that, you know, we let our wallets do the walking. We see something that looks like a great deal and don't consider, you know, exactly how much time and effort and expense it's going to take to get it up to snuff. And once again, probably, you know, on in excess of half a dozen times a day, I get this phone call from somebody that's trying to get their great deal running again, or it died in the middle of the highway. It's always something that they haven't had for very long. You know, it's, oh yeah, I just threw new batteries in it and I don't know where this wire goes or that wire goes, or, you know, it's when we prep a unit here at our facility, anything that's approaching that, you know, 10 years of age mark, our expense for the sales department is somewhere between $12,000 to $15,000. Sometimes it can be much more than that. And so I would be very careful. I think that it's wise money to have a qualified person come out and inspect the coach, no matter what kind of condition it's presented in. There are things that the potential seller maybe doesn't know about the coach, or they don't know to look, or they haven't used it in a really long time. But just to check out the major systems, like leveling systems, appliances, refrigerators, you know, air conditioners, run the generator, anything that is going to be extremely costly to repair should it go bad, take it out for a road test, look at the tires, or the, you know, just having a set of tires be out of date or have cracked sidewalls, that can cost you anywhere between, you know, $3,000 to $6,000, depending on the quality of the tire and how many tires.
Or if the tire blows, it could cost you thousands of dollars in body damage or your life. So
$10,000 is average for a tire blowout for us. That's pretty average for repair cost, and that's on the low side, taking into account some of the big ones. And then, you know, batteries. Like, if you have to replace tires and batteries on a coach, you're looking at a minimum of $5,000 in just those two expenses alone. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, make sure that the unit's up to snuff, that you can jump in it, turn the key, fire it up, and drive it away. If you can't at least do those things, I wouldn't even consider it. Yeah, fire the generator, make sure it puts up power. Turn everything in the coach on that has a high amp draw. Turn on the air conditioners, turn the refrigerator on 110. If it has gas appliances, make sure you light the gas appliances. You know, have somebody perform an LP check on it to make sure that it's not dangerous. At the barest minimum, all of the safety equipment in that coach is going to have to be replaced. Anything that
With the expiration date on it,
right? The LP detectors, the CO detectors, all of that stuff. It takes they have a limited shelf life, so yeah, all of that stuff goes bad. Check your fire extinguisher and make sure that it's reading in the green. You might need it. You never know. I mean, all of those things. If the owner potential or the seller can provide you with service documents, make sure they provide you with service documents.
All right, Sean, let's go back to the questions we got here. So this is a good one. You're out dry camping, and you have all of your food in the refrigerator, and you're not plugged in. You don't want to run your generator a whole lot because you're out in nature, and you don't want to hear that going. How long can your refrigerator run off of the coach batteries, assuming you got 4 to 6 batteries, kind of standard for a luxury Class A? Or just in general, even if you got a small travel trailer with 1 or 2 batteries, how long will your refrigerator run?
Once again, it's kind of a loaded question because there's different types of refrigerators.
And batteries.
Yeah. I mean, now they have come out with some strictly electric refrigerators that run on 12 volts and 110 and don't use gas. Then there are other RV refrigerators that run on a combination of 12 volt and gas or 110 volt. So let's start with those. So your traditional RV refrigerators, if you are firing them on gas and running them on DC and you're not running anything else in the coach, they'll run for an extremely long time because the amp draw is very low. All they're doing basically is using that to power up the circuit board and to hold the gas valve open and whatnot. So it's just powering some circuit boards and some of the components of the system. And that's pretty much it. And maybe the LP detector, the safety devices. So yeah, it'll run for a really long time, days and days.
And it depends too on the batteries. If you got 8 batteries or 6 batteries or 4 batteries, that's all gonna, you know,
in that
help
particular
with your capacity.
In that particular case, like even a single battery will run that refrigerator for a really long time because it's not using 12 volts as its mechanism, as its power source to cool. It's actually using LP. So then you have your second type, which is your strictly electric RV refrigerator, which these things are pretty new to the industry. So when DC power is available, they will run off of DC power. They'll run off the batteries. And once again, you know, it's all a math problem. You can look at your battery pack like a fuel tank in your car. The more batteries you have, the bigger your tank is, the farther you can go. And now if you have a lead foot and you're demanding a lot of, you know, your system, then obviously it's going to be depleted much faster than if you're not. So with those particular units, if you have an inverter or if you're plugged in and the refrigerator is wired into the inverter, it's going to default, you know, to the 110 power source. And so then you will consume power much faster on inverter power than you will on off of DC because you're powering the inverter and you're also drawing off the batteries for the inverter and the refrigerator. And those, anything that uses an element inherently is also not very efficient. And so that's why you won't see a traditional RV refrigerator usually wired into an inverter because it uses a coil, whereas these new ones use a small compressor that doesn't draw a lot of amps. And then the third type that you'll see is the straight residential type refrigerator. This is just like what you would see in your house. Fortunately, over the years, they've become much more efficient. The startup amperage on one of those compressors is, you know, 8-9 amps at the very most, and then run, they're somewhere between 2.5 and 3-3.5 amps. And so if you have a large battery bank, that thing, you know, it should run for a couple of days. But you do take for granted, in a lot of cases in dry camping situation, people are like, well, I only ran my refrigerator. Yep. You only ran the refrigerator, but you also have to power the inverter, and there's a certain price to be paid when you're taking that 12 volts DC and converting it into 120 volts. So there's always something sacrificed, so it's not free. Yeah. So yeah, you know, on a good battery bank, big coach like that, a couple days, you know, overnight is no problem usually. And when I say a couple days, that's because you got solar up on the roof. Yeah. It's going to help recharge.
That's going to help too.
So yeah, it's kind of a
answer's days, and it also depends on how much other stuff you're using as well. Because like you said, it's a fuel tank, so you use more of that fuel to power other things. It's going to be less available. And then at the very least, before you go to bed, I mean, fire up your generator for an hour and let it juice that stuff back up. So good, okay, thanks, Sean. Yeah. What about on that solar, if someone has a 24-volt solar panel, will that charge 12-volt batteries?
So any solar panel over 170 watts-ish is not intended to power a 12-volt system. That's when you start stepping up to 24 volts. Because when you take a solar panel out in the sun and you just hook a voltmeter to it, and test the open line voltage, right? What is it capable of producing? It's actually considerably higher than the 13.6 to, you know, maxing out at like 14 volts that a 12-volt system is, you know, going to run on efficiently. So what they use is they use a solar controller, and that takes that open line voltage and steps it down to that like 14.2 volts and regulates it and puts it into the batteries at a rate that the batteries will accept. So for instance, if your batteries are in a low state of charge, it's going to put much more energy into the batteries. Once the state of charge in the battery starts to rise, the amount of amperage that it's going to put into charging those batteries should decrease. If it doesn't, what ends up happening is you end up overcharging and boiling your batteries off.
Okay, and can solar panels power directly the batteries without an inverter? Does it have to go through that?
No, the solar controller, you need a solar controller. If you're going to have a solar panel, you do not want to hook a solar panel directly up to a battery. You can, but what happens is that battery is going to receive that open line voltage, and it's not getting a regulated amount of charge. And so you could potentially damage the batteries. Now, on a lot of the more modern solar panels, they actually have a diode built into the panel, and so that the energy can only flow one direction. It can only go towards the batteries, because the problem used to be in the early times of, you know, solar power, especially on RVs, where it wasn't very prevalent, it wasn't really well understood, people would just put wires onto their batteries, and then at night all of a sudden their batteries would magically drain, and that was because there was no diode. The energy could then flow the other direction, and the solar panels actually acted like a drain on the system.
Wow, interesting. I didn't know that. So with a 100-watt solar panel, what size inverter would be suitable for that? Just a single?
There would have to be more to the story. Like that, you know, and this is one of the questions that came in over the internet too. What size inverter is suitable for a 100-watt panel? I would say more that what size inverter is suitable for your needs? How many watts are you going to be using? What are you trying to power? How big is your battery bank? Those types of questions before you could really answer that, because the two are not really, you know, really depend on the other. If you're dry camping, one of the first questions that we ask people when they, you know, they state that they're interested in putting a solar system on their coach is what is your intention? You know, what are you going to be doing? Because in a lot of cases, people are just like, oh, I heard from my friend that solar is great and we need to have it. But then it's not like, well, why do you need to have it? How many overnights do you think you're going to do? a year where you're not going to have power available. And in a lot of cases, people are like, no, I'm always going to have it plugged in. You know, I don't need it. Then you don't need it. Yeah. There's no reason. I'm not going to sell you a $10,000 solar system for your couch that you don't need. You're going to be unhappy because at some point down the road, you're going to realize that you didn't need all this equipment. You're going to look at that Sean guy, man. He really sold me a, you know.
Bill of goods.
Exactly. So no, I don't want to do that. I want to tailor the system to the needs of the individual. And so if you tell me, hey, Sean, I'm going chucker hunting and I'm going to be unhooked for, you know, a month at a time, then yeah, I'll sell you a solar system. We'll make sure it works. You can watch, you know, football. You can watch NASCAR in high definition and cook your burrito in your microwave.
And take you with them.
You want to do, we can make it happen. Because you can live just like you live at home, just as comfortably off of, you know, a large enough battery pack, a big enough inverter, and enough solar. The only restrictive things really are, you know, how much do you want to spend, and how much roof space do you have? And
that's pretty much about it. So how about shutting off a solar panel? This is an interesting question. Can you shut it off?
You can put circuit breakers in, you can put cutoff switches in line so that you could conceivably shut your solar system off if you wanted to. But if it's set up right, you should never have to. You should never need to. If the system is set up with good quality components that are monitoring the battery condition and stepping down the charge rate as the battery voltage increases, you should never need to unhook it. If you had, say, a short in the system or something like that, that might be something different. But there should never really be a time when you need it. If you want it, just because you want it, then yeah, you just can install a large, you know, the power switch, like what you'll see in a lot of the large motorhomes and fifth wheels, where it's just a rotational switch, and the things are capable of carrying, you know, 500 amps. And so yeah, you can do it.
Okay. And then last question on solar is how to hook up a solar panel. How do I hook up a solar panel to my camper trailer?
Well, so the main components are going to be, you know, the solar panel, your circuit protection, your charge controller, and then your wiring. And so the way that it works is you find a good spot on the roof for your panel where you're going to have a good access to the floor level. And so if a trailer or a motorhome or whatever is not pre-wired for solar, usually the best shot, if it has an RV refrigerator, is to use the refrigerator vent cutout on the roof.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, because it goes all the way from the roof all the way down to floor level, and then you can actually drill through, you know, the floor at that point and drag your wire down all the way and then run it across a frame rail and over to the battery pack. And then you have to find a space, you know, interior wall space or a cabinet or, you know, a storage bay somewhere that you don't mind. If you want to watch your regulator do its thing all the time, you want to put it in the cabin. So then you bring your wire from your battery to your regulator, and then you plant your solar panel on the roof. You bring your wires down to your circuit protection, which is typically, you know, a fuse or a fusible length or a mechanical breaker. And then from the breaker to the solar controller, and that's pretty much it.
Wow, just that easy.
Just that easy.
Well, I'm glad that you're in charge of the service department. You know what's going on back there.
Yeah. The systems become much more complex as they become larger.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah. The equipment becomes more expensive.
Easier with a travel trailer than it is with a fifth wheel, than it is with a Class A.
Wire gauge increases. The size of your solar controllers increase. There's different types of controllers. You can actually run, you know, panels that were intended for 48 or 24 volt, but then they have to go through a charge controller, which is kind of different than a solar controller. It's a big beefed up one. A company called Outback makes them, you know, they're like $900. There's so many options. I mean, solar right now, it's not like the old days where you had a select few companies that you could go through. There wasn't a lot of product out there available.
Yeah, more and more popular, huh?
Everybody's making this stuff. So then it is also very hard to find, you know, good quality stuff. So talk to somebody that's done a bunch of installs, buy your equipment from a reputable company, have it installed properly, because you're penetrating the roof of your coach when you put those solar panels down.
Yeah.
And it's four screws per panel times however many panels you put up there. Every one of those is a potential for a leak. You know, wire drops are potentials for leaks. Wire connections, you want to make sure that they're watertight, because you're going to have snow and rain and stuff on the roof. So
sure,
it's important that it be done correctly.
Yeah, do it right or it's going to cost you more in the long run. All right, Sean, thank you so much for your time. This has been great. As you can see, Sean's got lots of knowledge. He's been doing this for years and years. If you guys have more questions, you did a good job on the website implementing those questions, and we're going to try to get to as many of them as we can. This is our last service seminar, so we're rolling into driving school coming up next. So May 27th, June 24th, July 22nd, August 26th, and October 28th is our driving school. So if you have an RV now and maybe your spouse does all the driving and you want to learn how to drive from some professionals, if you want to call us that, you should sign up for one of these driving schools. It's a great experience. It gives you an opportunity to have someone other than your spouse explain how all the systems work and explain how to drive it properly. So that has been really popular. And those do, we only have so many slots, especially with COVID. So if you are interested, make sure you sign up sooner than later. Also coming up immediately, May 14th through the 19th, we have the Prineville show. So we have a big RV show that we're doing out at Prineville. It's going to be a great experience. We're going to bring everything we can that's here on the lot over to it. And just an opportunity to get out of the dealership. The inventory always shows better. It's better spaced out. Everything's got slides open, lights on, all that stuff. So if you are out and about on the 14th through the 19th of May, come visit us at the Prineville show. We'd love to show you through our inventory.
Okay, so beyond basic questions and operating an RV and maintenance and whatnot, if you know of anybody or, you know, grandchild or a child or a friend that's mechanically inclined, that is looking for a career, maybe a change of career from what they've got going on currently, we're always looking for, people that can be taught how to fix, you know, recreational vehicles. There's an enormous need for them in the industry right now. You know, we need good quality people, not necessarily qualified. They don't need to know how to fix an RV refrigerator or an appliance, or, you know, perform an alignment or things of that nature. We spend a lot of money and time on training. But if, you know, they can show up every day on time, ready to work, be willing to learn, you know, be respectful and accept your task gracefully, then we can work with you, and we'd love to have you work with us. So bring your resume down to Beaver Coach Sales and Service. Talk to myself or Christina at the front desk, and we'll sit down with you and see where we can find a good spot.
Well, thank you very much for watching our service seminar. Hopefully you've got some good things out of it. We're Ryan and Sean with Beaver Coach Sales and Service in beautiful Bend, Oregon, and we look forward to seeing you down the road.
Thanks for joining us.